Good morning. Welcome to worship. I'm going to invite Sue Thompson up right away. We've got a special announcement here.
Good morning. Last week at the ministry's fair, the Christian education booth had a contest, not much of a contest, but a contest, to say what CE stands for. And it was interesting because the majority of entries came in, and I said, if you don't know, just put a question mark or say, I don't know. Well, the majority of them came in that way, which is what the committee kind of felt. People don't really even know what CE stands for. Sometimes when you're involved in things, you use this jargon and you think everybody knows what all the alphabet soup letters mean. But the Christian Education Committee, I'm new to it. I took over chairmanship this summer, and my mind was kind of blown. It is in charge of everybody from birth to when they pass away. We're in charge of helping everybody grow spiritually. And we are looking for a few new good men and women to join our committee. If you have interest, let me know, let Amanda know, let Jim know. You don't have to teach Sunday school. We have other jobs for you. But the fun thing I get to do right now is to give away the tickets that the Grand Theater donated. And we have two winners, McKinley Nelson. The Nelson family, are you here this morning? No Nelson family? Okay, we'll get them to them. And Fenimore's, are you here? Stephanie won? Neither of them are here this morning. I have to say that Stephanie's answer said, CE is in charge of everything. I loved it. We are. Join us.
All right, a couple reminders. CCPC 101 is coming up October 1st. If you're a visitor or new to the church and want learn a little bit more about the presbytery or how we operate as a church, feel free to RSVP and let Pastor Gates know. And that is October 1st after worship. Secret agents, we are still looking for signups for junior and senior agents. If you are 4th through 12th grade, you will be a perfect junior agent. We still need some adults to sign up. And just as a reminder, the exchange letters from October through March, and registration closes next Sunday. So please get signed up. You can do that online, or there is a sign-up table kind of near where you get your name tags. Next Sunday is Bible Sunday. They'll be giving away Bibles to 3-year-olds, 3rd graders, and confirmation students. So that's an exciting day for us all. And there's also a communion class after worship. It was originally going to be for youth, but everybody's invited if you want to learn a little more about, you know, how and why we do communion. And then Wednesday night programming, just a reminder, kids' life, youth group, and adult life. Check your bulletin for times on that and more information. And now let us prepare to feed our spirits as we worship together.
Good morning, church. Our call to worship this morning is in the Gospel of Mark. It's from the very beginning of our New Testament passage we'll read later this morning. Please join me. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. Let's stand and sing.
Call to confession. As Jesus begins his ministry, he calls people to follow him. This week, we have been tempted to be believers without being followers, but mental acceptance of Jesus' identity does not make us disciples. Even the demons believe that Jesus is the Holy One of God. Let us therefore confess our sins and choose today to follow him. Lord Jesus, we know that you have invited us to follow you.
In so doing, to know you, the Spirit, and the Father. But we have attempted to make the call of discipleship easy and the cost minimal. We often prefer to cheer you on from the sidelines rather than get involved in the game. Forgive us, Lord. Jesus, we are thankful that you chose to get involved in our lives and in our world. We are thankful that you paid the ultimate cost to bring us back to yourself. May we today leave everything behind that keeps us from following you.
Let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Believe the gospel. In Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Okay, I'm going to invite our kids to come join me up front. Hey, guys, come over here a little bit. Come so I can see you. Yeah, there we go. Come on over. There we go. All right. Awesome. Awesome. Okay. Hey, I am curious today if anybody has ever had a bad dream. Have you ever had a bad dream? I've had a bad dream. You don't have to share any details, but you want to share like what your bad dream was about? Like I had a bad dream one time about sharks that made in a swimming pool, and it was a really bad dream. I did not like it at all. Anybody else have a weird bad dream they want to share?
It was scary, not like bad.
Scary, not bad, but scary. Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah. Bats in a pool. That is terrible. We are having some pool-related trauma today. Okay, that's good. Snakes in a pool. We're really pool-themed here. Okay, that's good. If it's a pool one, I want to hear it. Go ahead. If it's not, I'm interested too. Green bird with a beak. That is an interesting, a gift-giving green bird. That does sound like a weird dream. So I'm with you guys, right? I've had a bunch of weird dreams too. And sometimes, boy, you wake up from a scary dream and you're like, it's really hard to go back to sleep, right? Sometimes we even like are afraid of things while we're awake. Last night, I was at church a little bit late and I was the only person here and all the lights were off everywhere except for my office. And it was like, it's like real creaky in the building, you know, and something would creak and I'd be like, who's there, you know? Have you ever had that experience too? Just been even scared when you're awake a little bit of something weird going on? So I keep coming back whenever I have those moments of a bad dream or I'm scared when I'm awake or something. I keep coming back to this song that I heard when I was a kid from a TV show called VeggieTales. Anybody ever heard of VeggieTales? Okay, some of you have. VeggieTales is like a whole bunch of talking vegetables, obviously. And they mostly talk about their faith in God. And I have a favorite song. So there's Junior is like the baby asparagus or the little kid asparagus. And he has a bad dream about something he saw on TV that night. And he thinks there's a monster in his room. And then his family comes in to like calm him down and make him feel better. And then they start singing. And this is the song they sing. Will you play my song?
God is bigger than my boy.
One more time. God is bigger
than the 49. He's bigger than Godzilla or monsters on TV. Oh, God is bigger than the 49. And he's watching out for you and me.
Okay, I love that song. No kidding, I've been singing that song for the last 24 hours. So like, I can't get it out of my head. What it tells me is it tells me anytime that I'm scared, right? Sometimes we're scared about silly things like pools or birds that give us gifts. Sometimes we're scared about like just it's dark in our room. Sometimes we're scared about real things, right? Like we get sick or someone we love gets sick, right? All kinds of things can be scary that are real or not real. In all of those situations, God is bigger. Right? God is bigger than everything that could scare us. God's bigger than our bad dreams. God's bigger than all of that stuff. And I love reminding myself, anytime I'm scared, anytime something is going on in my life that I don't like or doesn't feel good, I remind myself, you know what? God is even bigger and stronger than anything that I might ever be scared of. That's awesome, right? Because God is on my side. So if the biggest guy is on my side, I'm probably going to win, right? So I would love for you guys, next time you're nervous or scared or you have a bad dream or something, remember... Yeah, that's interesting. Doesn't work with my sermon illustration, but it's an interesting point. So I would love for you guys to remember that next time you have a bad dream or something like that, remember, hey, you know what? God is even bigger than this, and God's got my back, right? God's with me. Okay? Let's say a prayer. Gracious God, thank you for being bigger than everything that we could be scared of. Thank you for being bigger than the things we imagine and the things that are real. Thank you for always being with us. And thank you for always having our back. And we pray, Lord, that we would feel and know your presence in those scary moments so that we can have peace and know that we're safe with you. We love you so much. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right. Thanks so much, guys. You can walk on down to Children's Church with Miss Kim in the back. Good job. All right. As our kids make their way off to kids' church or back to their seats, we'd love for you to please stand and turn and greet your neighbor. You can be seated. We're doing like a Godspell thing, aren't we? I love it. Okay. This morning, our Old Testament passage is from the book of Daniel. We're going to begin in the 10th chapter. So Daniel is a prophet who is ministering during the Babylonian exile. He is in Babylon, or later becomes Persia, for all of his ministry. And We're going to pick up in this section as Daniel is praying and asking for a word from the Lord about when all of these things might change and his people could go home and they could be free. And in the midst of this prayer time, he has a vision of an angel. When you hear princes, princes means angels or the opposite in this story. Listen for God's word. In the third year of King Cyrus of Persia, a word was revealed to Daniel, who was named Belteshazzar. The word was true, and it concerned a great conflict. He understood the word, having received understanding in the vision. At that time, I, Daniel, had been mourning for 3 weeks. I had eaten no rich food, no meat or wine had entered my mouth, and I had not anointed myself at all for the full 3 weeks. On the 24th day of the first month, as I was standing on the bank of the great river, that is the Tigris, I looked up and saw a man clothed in linen with a belt of gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words like the roar of a multitude. I, Daniel, alone saw the vision. The people who were with me did not see the vision, though a great trembling fell upon them, and they fled and hid themselves. So I was left alone to see this great vision. My strength left me, and my complexion grew deathly pale, and I retained no strength. Then I heard the sound of his words, and when I heard the sound of his words, I fell into a trance, face to the ground. But then a hand touched me and roused me to my hands and knees. He said to me, "Daniel, greatly beloved, pay attention to the words that I am going to speak to you. Stand on your feet, for I have now been sent to you." So while he was speaking this word to me, I stood up, trembling. He said to me, "Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia opposed me 21 days. So Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I left him there with the prince of the kingdom of Persia, and have come to help you understand what is to happen to your people at the end of days. For there is a further vision for those days." Let's continue to worship.
Shining all our power.
Our New Testament passage this morning is in the Gospel of Mark. We're going to be in Mark for a season, for really now through Easter. And we are still talking about the coming kingdom of God in this section of Mark. And last week, we did sort of the introduction of the gospel. We're going to get into Jesus' ministry. We're going to be verses 16 through 39 of chapter 1. If you're following in your pew Bible, it's not going to read exactly the same. I got annoyed with the NRSV this week, so I made a few changes. So what's on the slides is what I'm going to be reading, and I would love your help. So as we go through, every time you see the word immediately, I want you to read it with me, okay? This is what annoyed me in our translation in the NRSV that kept using the same word and translating different ways. So every time you see immediately, just say the word with me, all right? Let's see how this goes. We're picking up with verse 16. As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. They went to Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, having entered the synagogue he was teaching, they were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And immediately his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. And immediately, having gone forth from the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her immediately. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed by demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout all Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We've all been told that two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time, right? Just makes sense. Have you ever tried to sit in the same chair that your brother tried to sit in first? It doesn't work super well. But I think also two kingdoms cannot occupy the same space at the same time. In fact, we have a word for this. We have a word for what we call it when one kingdom begins to occupy space another kingdom previously controlled. We call that an invasion, right? And in this story, we are getting the invasion of God. And so I thought it might be helpful for us this morning to give that some context. I want to think a little bit about the most famous invasion that all of us are aware of, which occurred on June 6, 1944. And I want to do so with a video somebody else made, but that has all footage original to the event. So as far as I know, except for the still shots in color, all of the video footage we're going to watch was recorded on June 6, 1944. This, of course, is the story of D-Day. Seen a lot of movies about World War II and D-Day. Somehow, seeing real footage feels different. Every time I come back to the story of that day and its significance, it strikes me that it is such an incredible metaphor for us to think about what Christ has done, as D-Day was to World War II and the liberation of Europe. So the life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus is to God's war and the liberation of earth. God's kingdom is coming, and there is already a kingdom on the shore where it is landing, and so two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time. And so what Jesus does here in the Gospel of Mark is the opening salvo of the kingdom of God's invasion of this world. And it is an unbelievably wild ride as Jesus shows up. We have sort of three big things that are happening. We have the exorcism of demons, which happens again and again and again. We have the healing of the sick, and we have the good news preached and the disciples called to this new teaching. And all of this comes with this incredible urgency, like you can imagine the commanders yelling at the troops. It's immediate, right? It's immediately. Get on the beach, take the land, keep moving forward. So I want to think about this invasion moment, the incoming kingdom of God, and these three huge things that Jesus does in the very beginning of his ministry here in the Gospel of Mark. And I'm going to start with the more exciting one. I want to talk first about the casting out of demons. So we have very few experiences in our world today with demons. We have a lot of experiences in our world today with mental illness. And so it's very easy for us to sort of map one on the other and say, oh, I think probably the demon possession stuff in the Bible is just people dealing with brain disease. They didn't understand it at the time. And I want to begin by saying there probably were some people in the ancient world who just had mental illness who got mislabeled. But that's not what's happening here in the Gospel of Mark. In the Gospel of Mark, the author wants us to recognize that as Jesus takes the beach, as he lands and begins his ministry, there is an enemy army already there, already possessing the territory. And that enemy army is the army of the guy he just met in the wilderness for 40 days. So in the Bible, demons are fallen angels, right? They are servants of the enemy. And we can tell right from our scripture that this is not a simple case of mental illness because these beings know information they could not know any other way. These are not simply ill people. They recognize Jesus, not just in his earthly identity, Jesus of Nazareth, but in his divine identity. You are the Holy One of God. The rest of the people in the Gospel of Mark, including especially the believers and the disciples, have no idea who Jesus is yet. It's going to take them 8 chapters to figure out he's the Messiah, much less to figure out he's the Son of God. But immediately, these spiritual forces recognize Jesus and call him out. By the way, I don't know why they name him. I don't know if they name him because it is an attempt to control him. In the ancient world, very often people thought if you knew the name of something, you had power over it. Or if they name him because they're just terrified and they can't, you know, do anything but exclaim his identity. Either way, in this moment, we are to recognize that as Jesus' kingdom comes onto the earth, there is an occupying force already there. And his interest is to remove them. It's probably worth noting that in the Bible, even those that are, there's possession and oppression in the Bible, and we're not going to get to oppression today, but possession is the idea that sometimes people can be sort of taken over by these demonic forces. We're not to believe that like they're permanent demon robots, right? So it's not like you can't ever have any of your own choices or willpower. But that there are times where these people were overpowered by the forces of the enemy, that just as humans are stronger than animals, so angels are stronger than humans. And so the point of this story is that Jesus is stronger still. The point of this story is that Jesus is stronger than the strongest forces on this earth, even those that are not of this earth, that God's kingdom as it comes is able to push out the enemy. Another way to say this is God is bigger than the boogeyman, right? He's bigger than the gorilla, Godzilla, and the monsters on TV. God's bigger than those that he came to fight. Mark wants us to recognize that you can't free France without getting rid of the Nazis. You can't take back the land unless you remove those who are occupying it. Now, removing the Nazis isn't all that it takes to make France a free country again, but it is an essential beginning for freedom. And more importantly, it's a battle the French can't win on their own. Satan's stronger than us, but Jesus is stronger than Satan. And the radical thing that Mark does in this story is he changes the location of the battle. So in the story of Daniel, we get some of the first texts about good angels and bad angels going to battle, right? We heard this weird thing about this man who's obviously not a man because he's glowing and fiery and his voice sounds like a multitude. So this angel comes to Daniel, but he says, I tried to get here and I couldn't get here for like a whole long time because the prince of the kingdom of Persia opposed me. And then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me and he dealt with him so I could come to you. Right? So Daniel is envisioning this idea that on the level of nations, God is moving and working, and there are forces opposed to God, personal forces of evil that are working against him. The Persian kingdom under the power of the enemy is opposed to the people of God under the power of God and Michael, God's servant. But Mark moves the battle from the scale of nations to the life of every human heart. Mark says, this is not just about whether we as a nation can become independent again or whether our nation can be a nation under God. He says every person is to be under God. Every person is someone that God has come to fight for and rescue and ultimately, we'll find out later, die for. This idea of Jesus' casting out of foreign powers on his earth is essential to Mark's ministry. So, first, Mark tells us about the work of Jesus in casting out these foreign powers. Then he talks about something slightly more mundane, but still miraculous. He talks about Jesus healing the sick. This is a really interesting moment. So Jesus goes to Peter's house, and Peter's mother-in-law is there, and Peter's mother-in-law has a fever. So today, we think of fevers as symptoms of diseases. But in the ancient world, they didn't really understand that. And so they sort of thought of a fever as a disease unto itself. And today, we get a fever most of the time. For most of us, we don't worry too much about a fever. You can take some antibiotics, you chug some orange juice, you take a nap, you go about your day. But in the ancient world, for obvious reasons, fevers were pretty serious. And so there was this understanding that this was a particularly challenging kind of illness. In fact, sometime after Jesus, there's a rabbi who wrote about fevers and compared them to the miracle where Daniel's three friends are thrown in the fiery furnace. And this rabbi said, "Greater is the miracle wrought for the sick than that for Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. For that of Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah concerned a fire kindled by man, which all can extinguish, whilst that of a sick person is in connection with a heavenly fire, and who can extinguish that?" There was this understanding in the ancient world, even in the Jewish world, that fevers were kind of a heavenly fire. Anybody can put out a regular fire, but who can put out an inside your body fire? And the answer is Jesus, right? Jesus can do it. And so Jesus immediately heals Peter's mother-in-law. And then something really important happens for the context of our story. We're told that after Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law, she gets up and begins to serve them, to minister to them. We've only had this language one time so far in the Gospel of Mark. It was what happened to Jesus in the wilderness after Satan left. The angels come to serve him or to minister to him. So what Jesus does for this woman is he gives her the opportunity to choose, and she chooses literally the side of the angels. She chooses literally to join in the work of the angels and serving the King of Kings. So we have the taking of the beach, we have the casting out of the enemy occupying force, and then we have this healing of this woman and giving her a choice to serve from her physical illness. She's healed. And then we have, throughout this story, the preaching of the gospel and the calling of the disciples. And this is really where the rubber meets the road for us. Jesus shows up and he sees Peter and Andrew and James and John on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And he says, "Hey, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men." And they leave everything behind and they follow him. And then Jesus continues into the temple and he teaches with authority a new teaching unlike what people have heard before. And then at the end of our story, Jesus says, hey, I'm not interested in staying in Capernaum and being a celebrity. I want to go on and keep preaching. My main mission is to push out the enemy and then proclaim this message. Mark wants us to understand that the most important part of Jesus' work isn't defeating the demons or healing the sick. The purpose of pushing back the forces of evil is to make it possible for humanity to answer the call of God. It is calling the people of this world to choose which kingdom they will serve. We are more than just victims to be rescued. God has a plan in which we can be a part. Two objects cannot occupy the same space at the same time, and in the same way, two kingdoms can't occupy our hearts. And so Jesus comes and invites us to be free of our world and to begin a new journey with him in this new kingdom. But it is a real choice that we make. Martin Luther, who wrote that beautiful hymn that we sang a little while ago, Mighty Fortress is Our God, Martin Luther described our choice like this. He said that imagine you are a horse, and there are two riders for you. One rider is God. One rider is God's great enemy. You don't get to choose whether you are a horse, and you don't get to choose where you're going, but you do get to choose your rider. And in this story, Jesus is beginning to make possible the choice for us to choose to be guided by God. Ooh, hey, fun fact. Let's talk about fishermen for a minute. We love this little language that Jesus does where he says, hey, I know you're fishermen, but I'm going to make you fishers of men. It's a great play on words, and Jesus is a great teacher, obviously. But I think we have heard that story and not thought deeply about it, right? We usually think, oh, he means evangelism. And he does mean evangelism, absolutely. But in the Old Testament, very often, fishermen, and being a fisherman is not just about calling people to God. It's more often about judgment. Again and again and again in Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Amos, Habakkuk, we get these metaphors of people becoming fishermen, and part of it is a judgment that God's bringing on the earth. Think about what happens to a fish when you catch it. Right? It's not always good for the fish, right? And so, in this story, as Jesus calls Peter and Andrew and James and John and the people in the synagogue and the people throughout Capernaum and the people throughout Galilee to consider who they want to guide their life, he invites them to be part of God's work of reclamation, of reconquering, of reconquest, of continuing the invasion. So, if we want to play out our metaphor a little bit further, in our metaphor of D-Day and the invasion, Jesus is the Allied forces, and the Satan and the demons are the Nazis and the German troops. There's a third party that we forget about. We forget about the French Resistance, right? La Résistance. And La Résistance was active long before D-Day. I mean, they were working ever since 1940 in the Battle of France, where their country was conquered. It was estimated that about 1-3% of all of the population of France was part of the French Resistance. And for years before D-Day, they worked. They were Abraham and Sarah. They were Moses and Miriam and Aaron and David and Elijah and Elisha and Ruth and Esther. They were those who had been preparing the way, like John the Baptist. And then, in the context of D-Day, there was a group of those French resistance fighters that got to be involved in the invasion itself. General Charles de Gaulle was informed by Winston Churchill on June 4th that the Allies would land in 2 days. The French Resistance had a number of plans in place. On June 5th, they activated Plan Violet. Plan Violet was the most important part of their contribution to Operation Overlord and the invasion on D-Day. It was the destruction of all the telephone lines and underground cables that ran throughout the nation of France. This was how the Nazi soldiers were communicating with each other, and without those communication cables, they were forced to use radios. And the radio transmissions had been hacked by the British hackers in Bletchley Park. And so, as soon as those cables and phone lines went down, the Allies had full access to all the German communications during all of the invasion of Normandy. During the Normandy campaign, the French resistance was so effective that the Wehrmacht completely abandoned the French phone system as unreliable. The other critical components of the French resistance in the context of D-Day were something called Plan Vert and Plan Tortue. I'm probably saying those wrong. On June 7th, the day after D-Day, the French resistance, in just a matter of days, had so effectively destroyed French railroads at 486 different locations that the German army had to give up transporting their troops by rail and begin transporting their troops over land by trucks, which led to the second part of the plan, Plan Tortue, where the Maquis forces of the French resistance, the armed soldiers, paired up with the SAS, the Secret Service of the British, and the OSS, the Secret Service of the Americans, and ambushed all of those German soldiers on their way to the battlefront. There were accounts where three-day journeys for German reinforcements took 14 days because of the French resistance fighters aiding the Allies. One of the British intelligence officers working with the Maquis bands said this: "It was hard to tell what they had been before German labor laws threw them all together in the depths of the wild woods. Some had been shopkeepers, artisans, young sons of wealthy parents. Others were scum of the gutter, and many were soldiers. Now, however, all were much the same. All wore the clothes, and many still the wooden clogs of peasants. Some lucky ones had scraps of uniforms and British battle dress, but predominantly their clothes consisted of drab-colored shirts, blue overall trousers, and German field boots, whose owners no doubt had ceased to require them for obvious reasons. They wore neither regular uniforms nor brassards of any kind. The only distinguishable difference between the men of the Maquis and the men of the country from which they had sprung was the pistol cocked aggressively from the trouser tops, the rifle on the shoulder, the sten on the back, or the string of grenades, depending on the belt." Those Maquis soldiers in the French resistance, that's you. Some were fishermen, and some were tax collectors, and some were zealots, and some were harlots, and some were once demon-possessed, but now they were all something else. That what Jesus is inviting the people to be a part of as he travels throughout Galilee is to be a part of the resistance, to say, hey, I am the strong man, I am the Allies, I will push out the enemy, but you get to be a part of that work. Jesus was named after another guy in the Bible. Nobody ever called Jesus Jesus. Jesus is like our English version of his name. Everybody who knew Jesus called him Yeshua, which would have been the Hebrew version of his name. Yeshua, we usually translate as Joshua. Jesus is named after this guy, Joshua, in the Old Testament. And in the Old Testament, Joshua is the disciple or the follower of Moses. He leads the people in an invasion of the promised land. He takes God's kingdom, the kingdom of Israel, and he invades these seven kingdoms of evil and wickedness, and he pushes them out so that there is room for God's people to take over. And at the end of Joshua's life, he preaches one final sermon to God's kingdom's people. And he says this: "Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did these great signs in our sight. He protected us all along the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God." Jesus comes to say, no longer is this a battle between nations. It is a battle between human hearts. But Jesus has made a beachhead. He's landed the kingdom of God. He has made it possible for us to access the Father. He has made a freedom for us to make some really simple choices. We are the choice. We are the horse who gets to choose its rider. We are the Frenchman who gets to choose whether to partner with the Germans or serve the Allies. We are the Israelite called in the days of Joshua. You are the fishers working by the lake. You are the people listening in the synagogue. One stands before us, heralding a new kingdom, and the strongest forces in this world cannot stand before him, and darkness is as light to him, and death is as life to him, and his kingdom is coming, and there is no time to wait. Everything is happening now, immediately, and so this day, choose whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's stand and sing. I want to ask you to be in prayer for our church family in a number of ways today. ask you to please lift up the family of Ruth Renneke. She passed away last week, but we will be celebrating her life this Saturday. So we'll have a service to celebrate her life at 11 a.m. on Saturday here in the church. We hope you'll join us for that. Also, want to ask you to continue to be in prayer for Deb Palmer's family. Her husband, Jim, passed away a week and change ago, and his service will be October 3rd at Brainerd Funeral Home, and you'll see more information about that in your email. Also, like you to be in prayer for Amanda Foles and Sheldon Rouse, who are currently on location in Mexico looking for a potential mission partner for our church. And so we pray for wisdom for them and safety for them as they are traveling and scouting out and reporting back to us. Let's come to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are reminded today that the work of Jesus is the work of bringing your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We are reminded that Jesus, by his power and presence, by his ministry, by his life and his death, by his resurrection, is stronger than all the other forces of this world that call us to choose them. We're reminded that Jesus has given us the freedom to choose to be part of your work of reclamation and liberation. And so we pray, Lord, that today we, like the people on the days of Joshua, like the apostles on the Sea of Galilee, we might say yes and choose not merely to believe in you, but to follow you, to make our lives part of your work of liberation and freedom for this world. We pray, Lord, that we would recognize it is in every human heart that this battle is waged, and in every person is of infinite value to you. And so we pray that you would help us to love them as you have loved us. And we pray, Lord, that as your church advances your kingdom, it would not be our names that are lifted up, but only the name of Christ. We thank you for your work of liberation in our lives. We thank you that you have made space for us to live in your kingdom even while we are on this earth. And we pray, Lord, that for your people living in your kingdom, they might have that sense of peace and hope and wholeness that makes darkness like light, and that makes death merely like going to sleep. And we pray, Lord, that today we could have that privilege of expanding your kingdom on earth. We pray for Sheldon and Amanda as they are scouting work and partners where we might serve you in other foreign lands. And we ask, Lord, for discernment in that process. But we also know that you send us not to foreign lands, but to our neighbors and our family and our friends and our coworkers. And so we pray this week you would send us out that we could herald the good news of the incoming kingdom of God. And so as we celebrate and participate in that work, we offer the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, Jesus has invited us to follow him today, and we can do that in a number of ways. Some of them are very simple. We follow Jesus by coming to worship every week and putting him first in our lives. And we're so grateful you do that. We want to know that you're here. So if you haven't done so already, if you could fill out your connection card so we can celebrate that you put Christ first today, that would be awesome. If you're worshiping with us online, please do that as well so we know that you are part of our church family this morning. We also get to be involved in the work of prayer for ourselves, for our world, and so we'd love the privilege of lifting up your prayer requests this morning. So on the back of your card, please let us know how we can be praying for you or for others. Our elders pray for those right after the service. Also, we get to give back to God with the gifts he's given us so that we can build up his kingdom in tangible ways. And so we invite you to consider how you're called to give to God with your tithes and your additional offerings. We have just 2 weeks left of our matching gift goal for our endowments. If you want to be involved in that, it's not too late. We have not hit that $25,000 mark yet, so we'd love for you to be involved in that. If you want to give towards that goal, just put endowment match on your check. I invite you to reflect on your prayers and your presence and your gifts as we continue to worship our God.
Thank you.
remind you, we are back to our regular calendar year stuff. So we got Women's Bible Study tomorrow at noon. We've got Life on Wednesday at 6 p.m. for kids and middle schoolers and adults, and high schoolers show up at 6:30. A lot of stuff going on, so just check your bulletin and find it. If you're here for the first time, we have a gift for you. It's a book by John Ortberg called What is God's Will for My Life? It's a short little read, and there are copies in the narthex. Just take one as a thank you for being with us. There's also Bibles out there. We'd love to take a Bible if you don't own one as a tool for your own life and walk with God. Also, if perhaps you've never made a decision to choose to not just believe but to follow Jesus, if perhaps you've never made a decision to be involved in his work and the incoming liberation of the kingdom of God, I would love to talk with you after the service and to pray with you and think of what that looks like. So come find me after worship and we have that conversation. Now, sisters and brothers, I pray that as you go out into the world, you would choose, as did Joshua, to make your life one of devoted service to the Lord our God. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.